So firstly, to introduce me, myself again, I'm Deepak Phatak. I'm a teacher here. I've been here for almost 40 years. I also happen to be principal investigator of the project for empowering 1,000 teachers, which is being conducted under the National Mission for Education and using ICT. You may have briefly seen me during the inaugural function, but I'm getting this opportunity to share my thoughts on some wider perspective with you. I'm sure you are enjoying the workshop and I'm sure you are benefiting from it. By the way, although I am not seen by you, but I keep track of happenings through the Moodle, the same Moodle that all of you use. And I'm actually thrilled to see several observations, comments, questions. Part of the ambition of this project is to nurture and enhance collaborative communities in future, and I am happy that that activity is also kicked off by all the participants here. Let me go back and talk to you about some teaching learning activities. All of us are familiar with those, but I'll go back a long way to comment on the notion of a teacher. You have seen all kinds of animal species living in this world. But take some other species, take birds for example. Who teaches them to build a nest? They do not have teachers. So presumably the knowledge of building a nest passes from generation to generation genetically, and partly by the young learning the art by looking at their own peers, parents and others who build nests. But essentially the passage of knowledge is genetic. Human knowledge grows extensively and much faster, almost exponentially, and it is not possible for nature to consolidate that knowledge and create a genetic transfer mechanism. Humanity realized this long time ago and therefore decided that to train the young of the species, they would require a different institutions. And that is the reason why humans created an institution called a teacher. And this is not new. Almost all the recorded history of 4,000 years of humanity, you will find mentions of teachers. To support these teachers, there were support structures that humanity created. Initially, these support structures were in the form of temples, mosques, churches. You even today see that these places of religious worship also double as support structures for some kind of teaching learning that is happening. Of course, over the years, the support structures took different forms. In India, for example, we had ashrams. Today, most of these structures assume the form of schools, colleges, universities, which is what we are all familiar with. Unfortunately, what has happened over the years is that these support structures, which as I said today are colleges and universities and schools, have actually become institutions. So we have Indian Institute of Technology, we have National Institute of Technology, whatever what. And we teachers have become paid employees of these institutions. There is a subtle but very important difference between the stature of a teacher when a teacher assumes the role of an institution versus when a teacher is a paid employee. When we work as paid employees, sure we have a commitment to our work, but that is almost always proportional to the kind of compensation that we are paid, because that is how we measure ourselves, that is how the world measures us. Whereas a teacher as an institution would work with a completely different level of commitment, with a completely different level of zeal. A teacher who is an institution will not at all be worried about how he or she is being evaluated by the rest of the world. He or she would be concerned mostly about ensuring that the students under his or her charge get the best of the knowledge, get the best of the learning, and become capable of solving real life problems, no matter what the world says. Unfortunately, such is not the ethos which prevails today. It is my contention that amongst us, there are several who who actually imbibe this philosophy of teacher as an institution. Unfortunately, most of us, instead of looking towards such teachers who are institutions in themselves, we look towards the other dimensions of our teaching profession, largely governed by issues such as compensation and so on. Why I say all this is that when we call ourselves teachers, we should always remember that implicitly society has given us an onerous task, an onerous responsibility, and we are accountable therefore to the larger society, no matter what we teach, where we teach, and whether how much we are paid, more or less. It is this philosophy that I would like all of you to adopt and nurture further. Coming back to engineering education, which is what is our primary domain of activities, we notice certain changes that have occurred in last maybe 25 years. First of all, a 5-year program was converted into a 4-year program. Most of you must be much younger, and therefore you would not be familiar with a 5-year program. But in those days, in engineering courses of any discipline, whether electrical, civil, mechanical, aeronautics, whatever, there used to be a basic minimum coverage of fundamental engineering topics for the first 2.5 years. And that sort of made every passing out engineer a fairly well-rounded personality in understanding fundamentals of engineering, no matter what particular branch one studied later on. Sadly, the conversion to a 4-year program and the first year primarily being occupied by fundamental courses in physics, chemistry and maths, which are of course essential, this emphasis on basic engineering has dwindled a bit. Consequently, most of our students tend to study their branch as the main objective and perhaps in the process forget the basic engineering principles. This dichotomy is accentuated further because more and more knowledge keeps getting added to each branch, and every branch attempts to try and put all of that knowledge into the slot available, which is 4-year slot or 3-year slot once the students come to the department. We fail to appreciate that this division of engineering into electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, civil engineering, aerospace engineering, etc., has been primarily done to address the growing body of knowledge well, so that people become well versed when they get training in a particular subject. However, this division is completely artificial, because as all of us know, knowledge is boundaryless, knowledge is all encompassing. So, what has happened is, for our convenience, we have broken the knowledge into these divisions, and then somehow we have created an impression amongst our students that as long as they know this part or this part, that is good enough. This has created a problem that the real problems in the world, which incidentally do not specifically come from any one branch or the other. On a lighter side, have you come across any problem in real life which comes to you and says, I am an electrical engineering problem or I am a mechanical engineering problem? I have not seen one. The real world says, I am a problem, solve me. Now, if the problem has to be solved, it will require application of knowledge from different fields. And given the paucity of time during which we train our students, it is quite possible that all of our students may not be well versed with all the dimensions of the solution of the problem. In such a situation, what is important is to stress to our students that while they might know well a certain topic or in a certain field, there would be other dimensions which they will have to learn while solving real life problems, and if necessary, they will have to take help from other people who are perhaps experts in those fields. That is the reason why increasingly you find that the real world problems need to be solved by teams of people. It is not just one person or one expert in one field who can solve the problem. Take the example of this workshop itself. We have 2 colleagues conducting this workshop. One colleague comes from mechanical engineering department. The other colleague comes from electrical engineering department. But both of them are together attempting to solve a real life problem, which incidentally is extremely critical for the nation, as all of you know. In exactly the same fashion, all the participants who are attending this workshop, independent of the field from which they come, they will have to either learn something of the other field or they will have to collaborate after going back to their own institution with people from the other fields. And let me tell you that it is not just the electronics and mechanical which is relevant. There are n number of other things. Take for example, the structures that you will have to build in order to capture the solar radiation. Neither mechanical engineers nor electronic engineers are absolutely well versed with the finer aspects of structure building. So you might want to take somebody from civil engineering department to help you who might have that kind of expertise. In general then, it is my contention and I hope you agree that almost all real life problems will require expertise from multiple dimensions to be applied to solve the problem, and particularly the more critical problems will require more of such diverse expertise to come. I hope that all of you have appreciated this particular aspect during this course itself, and you would carry this back with you and you would try to imbibe this in your students when you teach them, that they should look beyond just the particular field or subject that they are studying. I will also now touch upon a topic which will be close to your hearts, namely the quality of learning that our students do in our colleges and universities. It has been commented, I am not familiar with the mechanical and electronics engineering quality as much as I am with my own field, namely computer science and IT. And the leading industry organization, NASSCOM, has been commenting often that not more than 25% of our engineers are employable. What they actually mean is that the current problems which the industry is grappling with, which the industry has to solve for the clients all across the world, require certain skills, certain pieces of knowledge and certain attitude and aptitude which they don't find in majority of our students. I try to tell them to counter their thing that there was a time when there was no computer science in this country. There was only electronics which was closest to computers, and there used to be just about 5,000 annual admissions across about 80 or 100 colleges in the country. That's it. There were 5,000 electronics engineers, many of whom converted to computer science or IT later. There was no word like computer science and IT. Assuming that all 5,000 of them were 100% employable, which cannot be true because there would always be some people who would not be very good in their study, but still assuming that, the nation produced at most 5,000 competent IT engineers formally. Of course, in those days, as it continues even today, the IT companies proliferated recruitment across different fields. There are a large number of mechanical engineers, metallurgical engineers, aerospace engineers who learned programming and became successful IT professionals later. As opposed to that, there are more than 4 lakh students being admitted to IT, CS, electronics field today. So even if you assume that only 25% are employable, the number of employable engineers being produced by the nation to feed into this industry is multiple times larger. Now, this is the kind of scale that the nation has achieved in basic engineering education. Of course, the way it has achieved this scale is by establishment of a large number of institutions, mostly in private sector. Today, we have more than 5,000 engineering colleges. Many of you come from different colleges. Not all of them may be most up to date in infrastructure. Not all of them may get the best of the students who are prepared very well in higher secondary or something. They are relatively better than others who don't get admission to engineering. But still you would agree that a lot would be desired in terms of the basic preparation of the students who come to you. And then it is your task to somehow grill the basic engineering into them and then give them a degree. Concerned with this particular dilemma that when the nation enhances the scale, quality suffers, I wanted to understand myself what are the problems that are faced by the institutions, teachers and students, particularly at smaller places. In the year 2002, I took a 1-year sabbatical leave and went around the country. I visited about, I think, more than 65 colleges, and I particularly chose smaller places. And what I found was very interesting. Of course, the visits confirmed my suspicion, as you would all know, that there is a lot to be desired both in terms of infrastructure, in terms of number of teachers available, in terms of the qualification and experience of those teachers. There was a time, you know, when we were young students, our teachers would mostly be holding a PhD degree or at least a master's degree. In my own college from Indore, where I passed in 1969, I remember in 1964 to 69, there would hardly be one or two students who would have finished their B with fantastic results would be admitted as young teachers. They would be sort of trainee teachers. And while teaching, they would pursue their ME or MTech, but those would be very few. Today, unfortunately, a large number of our teachers did not have an opportunity to complete their ME or MTech, even ME or MTech before joining the teaching fraternity. Forget PhD. And that is a burning problem that most of us, many of you in fact, would have only a first degree, would be wanting to do a master's, but may not have had opportunities, would be wanting to do a PhD, but may not have had opportunity. This is a dilemma which the nation has to solve. However, what captured my thoughts during these visits was that in every college, where I would, by the way, give a talk to the students, talk to the teachers, and then interact typically with the final year students doing their projects. You know, all final year students are required to do a project. While sadly, many of those projects were very rudimentary attempts. At a couple of places, I even found that students who were explaining to me their project had no clue on what that project was. Clearly, they had borrowed that project idea and perhaps even the entire project report from someone else, and they are trying to submit it as their own. These things, unfortunately, are happening on an increasing scale, and we should be concerned about it. But that is not the main point that I wanted to share with you. The main point is that every small place, absolutely without exception, I found one or two or three batches of students, so maybe 4 students, maybe 12, 15 students at every place, who had done their project with a difference. They had applied their mind, they had done a lot of work, they had a lot of original ideas. They were not perhaps able to explain all their ideas in good English, because English was not their native language, as is true with most of us. But you could see their sincerity, you could see their application of mind, and you could see the talent in them. Additionally, what I was most pleased to observe is that in every institution, again without exception, there were a few teachers who were taking the task of teacher far more seriously than what an ordinary paid employee would. In my opinion, they were institutions in themselves. And these people I found at every small place without exception. 65 engineering colleges may not be a very large number, but I submit that statistically that number is significant. And if I found invariably at 65 places very good top class talent, the kind of students that I would love to have with me in IIT, and very good teachers, then it should be true that each of the 5,000 colleges would have such people. I would like to presume, because of the interest that you have shown in learning new technologies, that each one of you is like that. And I hope you will agree that in each of your colleges, you would have found such students every year. There may be 4, 5, 10, whatever. That is when, by the way, when I came back, I started the Eklavya project, because I thought these students and teachers across the country were like Eklavyas, wanting to get some direction, some mentoring, some help, because they wanted to excel. That is how we started this project. Under this project, we first attempted providing some guidance on final year projects to computer science students through web. Subsequently, I merged the distance education program, which I had started in 2000 in the School of IT here, to a larger level. And finally, we said to make a real impact, it is not the students that we should directly address, but it is the teachers that we should directly address. Initially, there was a lot of skepticism that without collecting people physically at one place, will you be able to make a difference? My contention was that yes, any interaction always makes a difference, whether it is an interaction across a distance or interaction personally. But I came up with this model of what I call a blended system of teaching learning, where people still physically assemble at one place, but not only at one place, they assemble at multiple places, which we call remote centers. And that is how we engage 1,000 people at 30, 35 remote centers. Each of the remote centers where you are participating, you will appreciate that there is a center coordinator, there is a workshop coordinator, there is a team of other expert faculty and technical assistants who are handling the afternoon labs, lectures, tutorials, assignments, etc. Lectures are given by the expert faculty from IIT. The preparation work that we do under this project is enormous. All the center coordinators, workshop coordinators are called physically to IIT Bombay. So, all these 35 senior colleagues assemble at IIT Bombay, they interact with the faculty members of a workshop and they then decide together what should be the syllabus, what should be the experiments, what should be the labs, etc., etc. This is done quite early. Afterwards, these coordinators go back and then they start preparation for this course in their own institutions. In this particular workshop, I remember that when Professor Solanki requested that since this is a new topic, not normally taught, experimental facilities are not available in colleges, and they were deciding to design and fabricate some experiment facility themselves. So, as an exception for this workshop, we conducted an additional coordinators workshop where all these people came and they discussed with our professors the experimental facilities and so on. If you feel that you are benefiting from the kits and from the experiments that you are conducting, please remember that there is an enormous effort not only by my colleagues here at IIT, but by the representatives of each remote center at each of the places. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all my colleague center coordinators and their associate staff. Now, this is about this workshop, but coming back to my theme, the idea was that I need to empower larger and larger number of teachers so that they can do their job of teaching better. The government and many people like to call it teachers training. Some people even called this program as enhancement of teachers. I dislike both these words. Why I dislike is when you say enhancement or when you say training, you presume that there is something missing in these teachers which you have to supplement. I don't agree with that. I think every teacher is individually and independently capable. I would rather call this as empowerment, and that is the term I like to use, because the more we are empowered using whatever external facilities and support we get, more we will be useful to transfer that knowledge, to add to that knowledge, and to create students who are top grade qualified. When we come to students, there is an unfortunate thought that prevails mostly amongst the minds of our students. And that thought is, somehow they should get a degree, as long as they get a good score, first class, 70% marks, 80% marks, they believe they will get good jobs, and that is their small time ambition. Most of our students have not thought through the entire career path spanning 40 years after they graduate. So, for them, the short term milestone of getting a job, later 3 years later getting a promotion, which are actually milestones, have actually become their dreams, and they don't think beyond that. Further, they firmly believe that the only criteria which is meaningful for fulfilling their dream is to get good marks in the exam. Consequently, their entire study, their entire learning is marks oriented. As a consequence, the entire teaching has also become syllabus oriented and exam oriented. I am making a generic statement. There would be many exceptions amongst us here who do not follow that philosophy, but by and large, that is the mentality of the students. So, there is a rat race for marks, and I won't blame students. You see, in the competitive world today, for everything that the students do from the day the student steps into the school is marks, marks and marks. If you get 90% marks, you are a genius. If I get 40% marks, I am an idiot. Now, this is told to me in 4th standard, this is told to me in 8th standard, this is told to me in 9th standard, and by the time I graduate, I have convinced myself that I am an idiot, and therefore, I actually start behaving like an idiot, becoming completely useless. This dichotomy has to be broken. A rat race for marks, by the way, results in a few winning rats and a large number of losing rats. All of us have gone through that dilemma, by the way. All of us were students. Some of us won, some of us lost. And each one of us won somewhere and lost somewhere. So each one of us is simultaneously a winning rat and a losing rat. A winning rat in some sense and a winning rat in multiple sense. What happens to a winner rat? The winner gets overconfidence. And very often that overconfidence morphs into arrogance. Oh, I know everything in the world, so I don't need to learn anything. This arrogance needs to be bashed. You would have seen such students, the toppers in your college and so on. Sometimes they behave arrogantly. I get to see them for last 40 years every year because the joint entrance exam entrance or the GATE toppers, etc., who come here, we have to spend quite some time telling them that, look, you are good, you have done well, but everybody around you is exactly same, including the teachers who also come from the same rigmora. So please behave yourself, come down to the earth. While you may know a lot, there is a lot more to be learned. It takes us 3 months, 4 months, first full semester to bash their arrow. Because arrogance is useless. Arrogance will mean that I will stop learning because I have assumed already that I know everything. Take, on the other hand, the case of a large number of losers. Losers acquire diffidence. They start believing that there is something not good in me. And sometimes this diffidence morphs into despondence. As I said, if I get 40% marks consistently, I start believing that I am an idiot. And actually, I start behaving like it. Now, this despondence is also contraindicated to the healthy growth of that human. Here is my submission. Independent of what marks say, good, bad, you got 90%, you are great, I got 40%, I am an idiot. Independent of this, I submit that every human being has sufficient intellectual capability to solve reasonably complex problems in life. The example that I like to quote often is learning a foreign language. Some of you might have tried this. I know people, for example, who try to learn German. They attend a 1 year course in elementary German language. They learn something, lots of books, exams, certificates later. Some of them do a 1 year advanced course. So they supposedly become better. I have seen some of them wanting to further brush up and refine their knowledge of German language. They go to Max Müller Bhavan in Pune, spend 6 months talking to people, conversing with them, etc. And at the end of all these exams, certificates, etc., etc., when they come back, they can speak German reasonably well. Not as fluently as a German would, but they can speak, they can understand, they can read and translate and so on. And what do we call such people? Well, very smart people, must be very intelligent. He has mastered a foreign language. So you would agree that learning a foreign language is a reasonably complex logical problem, and that people who perfect that solution to that problem must be intellectually of great capacity. If that is so, then I would like to ask you a simple question. Each human child learns a foreign language between the age of 3 years and 6 years. That foreign language subsequently is called the mother tongue of the child. You got 90% marks, you learnt your mother tongue, whether Telugu or Tamil or something, when you were 3, 4, 5 years old. My mother tongue was Marathi, I got 40% marks, but I also learnt it during that time. And believe me when I say this, at the age of 5 years or 6 years, you were as conversant with that foreign language as I was with mine. I could understand everything that people around me told me, and I could make them understand whatever I wanted to say. I could, of course, not converse in technical terms like engineering, but I could solve my problems and I could understand the problems posed by them. I was reasonably competent in a foreign language, which incidentally was the first foreign language. And the world of literatures will tell you that learning a second language is always easier as compared to learning the first. What does it mean? Does it mean that all children are equal in intellectual capacity? No, I make no such claim. There are, of course, differences. Take singers, for example. There are singers and singers and singers, but there is one Lata Mangeshkar, one Mohammad Rafi. So there would be differences. I am talking about the basic capability. And I am suggesting that the basic capabilities, God has given each one of us adequate capability to solve the problem. The question is, what is it that happens in the life of these children, all these children, including all of us, who learnt a foreign language at the age of 5 years subsequently become useless in the eyes of larger world. According to me, there are some very fundamental characteristics of a human which are best seen in the childhood, but which later on get curbed because of various things, including sadly the impact that we teachers make. Let me list the 4 qualities which I consider to be exceptionally important and to be innately present in every human child. These are: 1, curiosity. Every child is immensely curious about everything that the child sees. The second is boldness. A child asks questions without fear to anybody and on anything. In fact, sometimes children ask embarrassing questions and we don't know how to answer them, but we humor them. It is this boldness which prompts a child to ask a question on anything of concern to the child. What happens when the child grows up and comes to the school? Let's say in 5th standard, I am a bold child, I am asking questions again and again. Some teacher like me and you will say, please don't disturb the class, please don't ask too many questions. What happens when we go to the 9th standard? Emphatically said, don't disturb the class, don't waste classes time. When I come to engineering, sometimes a teacher who thinks that he has explained something well, but I have not understood, I raise my hand and ask a question, he says, don't ask idiotic questions. What is the system doing to me? It is killing my boldness, and in the process, it is killing my curiosity. Please remember that the boldness is nothing but a manifestation of curiosity. When a child asks a question, it is not asking you the question really, it is asking itself. It is only articulating that question to you. The child is articulating its curiosity to you. When you kill that questioning, you kill the curiosity, and sadly, the learning stops. It is my humble contention that 11, 12 years of schooling and 4 years of graduation is a process while we try to ram a whole lot of knowledge in the minds of people, but at the cost of these fundamental beautiful characteristics called curiosity and boldness. And there is a 3rd important characteristic. That characteristic is perseverance. Every child, once it decides to do something, it will never give up. Have you seen any child who gives up anything that it comes to his mind? Doesn't matter what it is, particularly naughty things. Consider, for example, there is a bottle kept on the desk here, and a child looks at it and wants to somehow throw that bottle down. All children love to mess around with it. What will the child do? It will try to come around, try to climb up on this table. It will not succeed. Of course, the table is very tall. Child will fall down, try again, again it will fall down. Maybe 3rd time it will hurt itself, start crying. 5th time when it tries, the mother will catch the child, mother will shout at the child, ask the child to stand in a corner for 5 minutes. The child will stand in the corner, crying, weeping. After 5 minutes, the child will look here, child will look there, and again go to the same table, again pursuing the same agenda of taking the bottle and throwing it down. Maybe 10th time, 11th time, it will ultimately find some chair, some stool, stand on it, go on the table, and take this bottle and throw this down. And when the bottle breaks, the child will dance with dawn. That joy, I think all of us miss. When did you last dance with such joy? I'm not suggesting that as grown-up teachers we start climbing on tables and throwing glasses around. But the point I'm trying to make is that we have forgotten this beautiful, important characteristic of perseverance, of not giving up, no matter how many failures. And our school and college teaching and learning system is at least partly responsible for it. Look at it. When I go to the 5th standard, I am still attempting to solve difficult problems. But slowly I learn that in the examinations, I am asked simple problems. So there will be no motivation for me to attempt harder problems. Slowly I will take a simple problem, I will attempt it once, I will attempt it twice. After some time, if I don't get it in the first attempt, I just give up, I don't try second time. So forget the harder problems, even simple problems I won't try. Why? Because they are not important from an examination point of view. You know, I have been teaching in IIT system. Some of you are lucky to be teaching in institutions where you are given a lot of autonomy. But in most colleges, we do not have this kind of autonomy. You are not encouraged to set difficult problems. In fact, many of you may not be able to set question papers yourselves. In IIT system, that is an extraordinary privilege that we get. What I teach is the syllabus, and what I set is the question paper. And what I evaluate and award is the grade. That's an extraordinary responsibility, but that also means that I can always get the latest in the literature into my course. That I can always challenge students with the toughest of the problems. I am encouraged to give you one more example which happened here from a colleague. These are the senior colleagues from whom we learn. A colleague, late Professor K.C. Mukherjee, used to teach electrical engineering. And he used to teach electrical fields. I had just become a young teacher then, and I was still close to some of the students who used to play chess with me in the institute chess team earlier. And one student one day came with a terminal exam paper and gave it to me and said, Fatak, how do we solve this question 3? I looked at it, it was the electrical fields paper. Of course, I could not solve that problem, but I haughtily told him, I am now a computer science professor, so it's not my field. He said, no, you have an electrical engineering degree, you should be able to solve it. We looked at it for another 10 minutes, we could not solve it. We both went to Professor K.C. Mukherjee. When he saw the paper in our hand, he immediately realized something and he started smiling. We went to him and he said, so Fatak, question 3. I said, yes, sir. So he didn't say anything. Then I asked him, sir, what is the solution? He says, I don't know. And both of us were shocked. We asked him, sir, what do you mean you don't know? He says, Fatak, this is part of an unsolved research problem which is pending for last 10 years. But you know, this batch is so smart, I thought somebody in this batch will solve the problem. So I put this in the question paper. Imagine what would have happened in most of the universities. Back home, even 40 years ago in my college, there would have been a dharna at the vice chancellor's office. Syllabus ka bahar ka sawal pucha. Throw away that teacher. That is the difference. The students accepted it, and not only accepted it, the best part of the story is the later part. In that evening in hostel 4, where majority of those students were there, they were having a milkshake party in the evening. A milkshake party those days used to be given by the students who would win, for example, an inter-hostel football match, or somebody wins a cultural trophy or something, major event. So the general secretary of the hostel was passing by, he came saying, why are you having a milkshake party? What great thing has happened? And one student said, oh, you don't know? The great Professor Mukherjee thinks that we can solve unsolved research problems, so we are celebrating. Now that is the ethos. Here is my submission. While majority of your students may not easily imbibe this ethos, but in every institution, there would be 5, 10, 12 students who think differently, who are willing to work differently, who are willing to be challenged by harder problems. Isn't it our responsibility to do so as teachers? Of course, as teachers, we have to look after the entire class, and we are naturally expected to spend more time with the weaker students. But here is my submission. Unless we are able to do something special for the better performing students of the class, we are not doing our duty fully. Why? Because the better performing students of the class, when they learn that challenging problems can be attempted and failures is no problem, they will get more vigorous in their problem solving ability. And they are the people who are likely to make a greater difference to the world, to the nation. So here is my request. Please go back and spend more time with such students. In fact, one of the objectives of these workshops is to imbibe, I would not say IIT style teaching, but I would say a different method of teaching and learning, where emphasis on hard problem solving is perpetual and constant. And that is where, that is what the challenging problem makes my mind think, makes my mind apply itself to a larger extent, and that is how we learn. So this is my request. From this workshop and from other workshops, try to imbibe this philosophy. There is something else that is happening here which I really like. You know, we use Moodle very extensively in our courses. We also use our own website for variety of access to the learning sources. And we, many of us believe that good learning sources, learning material, teaching material should be in open source access. One of the objectives of these workshops is that all the contributions made by teachers, and not only the teachers who are teaching this course, their slides, their video audio lectures, all of these are getting recorded and they will be released in open source for open access to anybody. In exactly the same fashion, contributions made by the participating teachers will also be converted into readily accessible material on a web portal, and all of that will be released. It is for this reason that I had requested all my teacher colleagues who are conducting these workshops to tell participants to do some exercises after the conclusion of this workshop. Maybe they spend 1 or 2 weeks, maybe they spend this time in teams or individually, and they could do absolutely anything which will add to the value of the content. They could add, for example, questions and answers, they could add lab experiments, they could develop in a course like this, they could perhaps develop a small hardware or a small system which could work in conjunction with this experimental kit or which could work independently. I have suggested to Professor Solanki that he should consider releasing the design and fabrication details of this experimental kit in open source so that some industry will come forward and start manufacturing and start supporting such thing. All the material that you so develop could also be added to the open source. One of the main objectives of these workshops is to create and nurture collaborative communities. We don't have such collaboration. When we go back to our colleges, I am a lone teacher teaching one subject and I have so much load that I don't have time to think and time to interact with others, except perhaps with my own colleagues in my own institute. Here is a chance. The extraordinary electronic network that is being created, the extraordinary facilities that you have today will permit us to access knowledge. After all, we all benefit from accessing Wikipedia, accessing other sites. We are trying to set up a portal under this scheme. That portal will be released sometime in January or February, which will have the contents and the contributions from all the teachers for all the workshops that we have conducted. Additionally, this portal will be open not only for access, but for continued contribution. I would expect many of you, in fact, to come forward and become editors for those contents, because sadly, people do not write those contents either properly, or sometimes when they make contributions, they forget to mention that this material is from such and such site or this material is from such and such reference. Please understand that when we release the material in open source, it is our responsibility to ensure that the intellectual property is either ours, which we are gladly giving away for releasing in open source, or if it belongs to somebody else, then we take proper permission from that person or that source before sending the material for release. This is a precaution that I would like all of you to take. I will conclude by saying that if you think this workshop has benefited, we propose to conduct these workshops, continue to conduct these workshops in coming years. I have suggested to the ministry that there has been an increasing clamor for participating teachers, that apart from the introductory courses, there could be some advanced courses and even some research courses, because that is exactly what most of the teachers will benefit directly from. The ministry has agreed, but has suggested that the funding model has to be relooked at. The ministry cannot continue to fund endlessly the complete conduct of the workshop, and that is the reason we are collecting a feedback from participating teachers whether they would be willing to attend these workshops even if they are not funded. Will they be willing to spend money from their own pockets for at least their travel, stay and food? And some of you might even be interested in paying the fees for a course. Workshops, additional workshops that I was mentioning, I'll mention two workshops which might interest you, because these are independent of the field of studies that you are engaged in. The first workshop is on technical writing. It is expected to be at the most a 2-day workshop. We are proposing to hold it on the fourth Saturday, Sunday of January. This was primarily initiated to permit those teachers who want to submit technical papers in the upcoming conference on educational technology. Because in the past few years, we found that the submissions were not up to the mark, even the language used was not correct, the papers were shoddily written. So we thought that we will conduct a workshop for such teachers. I suggested that this could be a common problem faced by most of our teachers. So I am trying to call this a technical writing workshop for 2 days, where people who are willing, who want to submit whatever little research work or survey work they have done in the form of a paper, or they want to write a report, then they should be helped in this. So this we are trying to conduct. This model will be a different model because this will not be a fully funded course. We will fund all our remote centers in conduct of these workshops, but the participating teachers will have to spend their own money to come for a day or two and attend these workshops at their own cost. I am sure that many of you would be interested in doing so. More importantly, another workshop which we have planned in next May or June is on research methodology. This workshop is an outcome of a course which was conducted by Professor Karmalkar of IIT Madras in IIT Bombay a year and a half ago, jointly with Professor Patwardhan of Chemical Engineering. And this was meant for our research scholars. And this was an amazing workshop. In fact, the lecture slides of a lecture material for those workshops, for that small engagement, has already been released by us in open source. But I have requested Professor Karmalkar to construct a full 1 week program. He talks not only about the general nature of pursuing research, but he talks of all lots of attendant problems, including motivation, including hard failures that one may face, including the problems in finding a guide, including the problems if I have a fight with my guide. When you pursue a PhD, there are a whole lot of issues: how to conduct formal experiments properly, how to record those experiments, how to analyze the results of those experiments, variety of things. Believe me when I tell you this, it's an absolutely top class workshop, a top class material which I have asked him to convert into a full 1 week IST workshop. Whether it is 1 week or 2 week, we'll find out. It's mostly a 1 week workshop. And this workshop will again run on a model where it will be partly funded by the MHRD project, but partly you will have to fund yourselves. Since it cuts across disciplines, I am sure that out of about 2 lakh teachers that we have in this country, maybe at least 10,000 teachers would attend. We propose to run this workshop from 200 remote centers, and we'll be augmenting our remote centers in a short while. The reason I bring up this topic is currently we have about 70 odd remote centers which have helped us in conducting these workshops at large places. Any one workshop might be using 30, 40 remote centers, but we have these larger. But those of you who work in an institution which might have such facilities as you would have seen in a remote center and would be willing to consider becoming a remote center in turn, please do visit our website. There is a form which says that if your institute is interested in becoming a remote center, you give us this information. Some of our representatives will visit your institution and will arrange for all the training in AVU and all other things, tell you about all the requirements, etc. But my own ambition and dream is that this country should have at least 200 remote centers in the next 6 months from which we could proliferate such courses. And of course, the technology being used is so simple, we are preparing a documentation for it. There is no reason why any one of your own institution cannot start beaming these courses to other institutions who are interested using exactly the same technology. I have suggested to Dr. Kamal Bijlani that the AVU technology should also be open source. He told me that as far as the colleges are concerned, educational institutions are concerned, it is available to them free of cost. So please try to utilize it to extend it further. Oh my God, I have really exceeded my time. Sonki, sorry, I must conclude now. But I'll conclude with one special request. All of you are familiar with the so-called demographic advantage of this country. The number of Indians who are less than 25 years old are so large in our country that they outnumber the total population of many large countries. The challenge before the nation is if we can give them the best of education, and then if we can give them the best of opportunities to show their mettle, they will not only become great people, but they will contribute to the wealth generation of the whole nation. And that is an advantage, but that is also a challenge. It is my humble submission that the front wave of that demographic advantage is actually students in your colleges. And depending upon how well you enable and empower them in turn, after getting empowered either through such workshops or after getting empowered on your own or after getting empowered by looking at some great teachers around you, it does not matter. But I am suggesting that the responsibility that you have is extraordinarily large, because these are the people who will make a difference to the future of the nation. The nation will be grateful if you can contribute in exercising this responsibility. If there are any questions on this session, we would like to take that. Is Jai Chamaraja College, Karnataka?
Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
Your talk was very nice. In the beginning, you said that you had a 5 years course, engineering course.
Yes.
Why can't we reintroduce that now, so that we can teach the students better and all the students will become employable?
I have my wholehearted support to such a suggestion. But given the competitive maramari that is going on around the world, around us, anybody suggesting increasing the course duration is likely to be lynched by the mobs. So that may not be acceptable to the students. I have been making this suggestion, but I don't think the educational administrators of the nation are interested in this. Sadly, therefore, it is our responsibility as teachers to do what was being done in a 5-year program, to do it in 4 years. And that is why we have to spend extra time and we have to make students spend some extra time. Thank you so much. Let's go to some other institution. This is VPCOE Baramati. Over to you.
Presently, remote centers are functioning at mostly engineering colleges. If some science institute is ready to work as a remote center, then what procedure is to be followed?
Okay. Very good question. You have touched a raw nerve. The Honorable Minister, Mr. Kapil Sibal, had asked me, why am I limiting these efforts only to engineering college education? And I told him that is something I understand a little better. But he has been constantly telling me, and the ministry has been telling me, that can we not extend the same principle to college education and even to the school education. I have agreed to, as an experimental basis, to do something for the school education, for empowering teachers of schools as pilot over the next 6 months, and another empowerment as college teachers for some of the subjects. Incidentally, some of the courses which are taught in other colleges, such as basic computer programming, we did permit teachers of other colleges also to join us. Your specific question about a remote center, there is only one impediment. The remote center must have facilities for the laboratory work, which traditionally are available in engineering colleges. But you are right, wherever there are subjects such as a technical writing subject or a subject on research methodologies, which does not require any experimental setup, we will be very glad to have engineering science colleges as also remote centers. And in those subjects where the associated experiments could be done in the science college itself, we would have no problems in doing that. So your suggestion is well taken. I will definitely consider it. And I would request you, if you could send me a small mail elaborating further and perhaps suggesting some colleges in your region who might be interested in becoming a coordinating center or remote center for our project. Thank you very much.
Is it possible to have two remote centers in the same city?
It is definitely possible to have remote centers in the same city, but our problem, we have some cities in which we have multiple remote centers. The problem is that the number of participants coming to that city, if they are limited and if they get fractionalized into multiple remote centers, then sometimes the course from a funding perspective does not become viable to be run at remote centers with capacity filled up less than the minimum. I will tell you why. Please understand that while we are funding all expenses for participating teachers, and which, as I said, we would like to shift away from that model, as far as the remote centers are concerned, we fund the entire expenses. And these expenses are not linearly changing as per the number of participants. There is a minimum expense even if there is one participant at a remote center. Therefore, if there are too many centers in the same city, and if some centers do not as a consequence attract adequate number of participating faculty, the conduct of the course becomes unviable from the funding. That's the only restriction. Otherwise, my own motto has been more the merrier. Jabalpur Engineering College wishes to connect. Yes, I can see you, Jabalpur. Over to you.
Sir, the present condition, we facing the problem. There is the good research facility is only available will be limited places, just such as IIT. But the step taken by the government, this facility also will be able to the other universities or other places.
Okay, very good question. Thank you for asking this question. My own dream has been that today, for example, IIT Bombay is a hub to which all these remote centers are connected. But you are absolutely right. There is nothing in the technology that we are using which cannot permit its utilization at any other place. I mentioned that some time ago. The AVU technology is accessible and available for all people. You need to set up the servers and so on. The facility to conduct a workshop is as much there in any other institute as is there in IIT. I have suggested to the government that like IIT Bombay is a hub, there should be 100 such hubs in the country, 100, not one or two or three more. And there could be local hubs. For example, Jabalpur Engineering College could become a hub for a set of courses and workshops to be conducted in areas of your own specialization for any number of institutions which are interested in conducting this. That is one of the reasons why the MHRD secretary told me that Phatak, we need to move more and more towards self-sustenance, because the government cannot fund a large-scale proliferation. But I told her that, madam, in my opinion, there are larger and larger number of teachers that if they see the benefit to themselves accruing from these workshops, they will be willing to spend money from their own pocket to attend these workshops. With this model in place, we are preparing a documentation on how to set up a hub, what equipment is required. For example, if you want to become a hub like IIT Bombay, what equipment you need to set up, what teams of people you need to build, both the technical and administrative teams, because you will have to interact then with the remote centers directly and do all the paraphernalia that our center does. We will be setting up a documentation for using of this technology, the documentation for the methodology that is to be followed, the documentation on how to conduct the courses, the documentation on how to collect the contents and release them in open source. All of this is expected to be ready by end of January. And all those manuals will also be open source. They will be available, in fact, on the Moodle for these workshops. So you are welcome to start thinking about it. And I will certainly make sure that apart from putting this information on the web, we'll send a copy to you. As I plan to do it, I am proposing to send a copy to all the participating remote centers, because it is my earnest hope that each of the remote centers, which is actually transmitting courses conducted by IIT Bombay, can in turn start conducting these workshops on their own. Thank you for asking that question. MNIT Bhopal has a question.
Sir, it was a very inspiring address from your side. I have one question. You talked about four qualities of that have to be inculcated: curiosity, boldness, perseverance, and I think you missed the fourth one.
Oh, okay.
Please tell us in detail about that also.
Okay.
And secondly, I wanted to say that our present system of appraisal doesn't give much weightage to teaching of a teacher and laboratory work, the efforts he takes in class and laboratories. Rather, it focuses more on his efforts in research and other activities. So if something could be done in that direction, I think the teaching will improve, the efforts will be more from the side of a teacher. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this question. And I'm sorry that I missed out on the fourth, which is, I believe, an equally important characteristic. The fourth characteristic is excitement and passion. A child is always excited about everything it does. That excitement and that passion keeps driving the child in spite of the failures. And it is that excitement and passion we often start missing when we grow up. Many times, because the work is of a mundane nature or a repetitive nature, we don't show the same excitement and passion that we do things which a child does. So that is the reason why I say that somehow if we can rediscover the child in ourselves and recall our own curiosity at the age of 5 years, our own boldness at the age of 5 years, our own perseverance at the age of 5 years and our own excitement and passion at the age of 5 years, I think we would be doing far greater job for ourselves and for the rest of the world. But I would like to add one more thing which also I missed. There are two additional very important characteristics which unfortunately the God has not naturally endowed amongst children. These characteristics are nothing to do with the life of a species. These are special characteristics which are available only with human beings, and these are part of our human culture. Let me just mention these two. The first one is humility. A child does not have humility. The child is not humble. Many times the child is very arrogant, very insistent. Humility is required when we deal with large number of people around. We must learn to carry our knowledge very lightly. The more you learn, the more humble you must be. That is what all the philosophies say. This humility has to be inculcated in the children. It does not come natural. The second equally important thing is to inculcate in the children is ethics, because ethics is not part of a natural survival instinct related characteristic. Young children are not ethical. They are very possessive. They will possess everything. They will take something from somebody else and they won't feel bad about it because they are doing it because of their self-interest. It is the social norm. It is the norm of good behavior in the society which demands ethical behavior from us. And if ethics and humility is not equally well inculcated from the childhood, when we grow up, sometimes we tend to neglect these. You will see that is the reason why students copy. You will see that is the reason why people do funny things, why people become corrupt later. All of these are traits which show that we have been unable to incorporate strong ethics when the students are young. So I would submit, thank you very much for reminding me of missing the fourth characteristic, but I have added two more which are artificial but extremely important for the normal growth of human society. So remember those four. The fourth one is excitement and passion, and remember two equally important things, humility and ethics. And I think we as teachers must become role models, because whatever we do is often copied and aped by other people. I forget the second part of the question.
Sir, it was about the contribution of a teacher to teaching his work in laboratory.
I wanted to tell you an example which I saw, I think somewhere in Odisha, in one of my visits, in one of the colleges I had gone, and I usually keep asking people, what else do you do other than syllabus and so on. And one electronics teacher sheepishly told me that he runs a lab on Sunday. Every Sunday morning for 3 hours he runs a lab. And then I asked him, what does he do in that lab? He says that, sir, we take up some problem, we analyze that problem, we design a circuit and we fabricate that circuit. We meet for 3 hours every Sunday, most of the Sundays, and at the end of the semester, this circuit is built. And then I said, this is wonderful. He said, but sir, not all students come. I have 60, 70 students, only 10, 15 students come. I said, my dear friend, those 10, 15 students are going to make a difference to the world and to themselves, because they are coming on a Sunday. They know that whatever they are doing is completely useless from an examination point of view, and yet they are coming. So you are doing something great. You know what he told me? Sir, you are amongst the very few who appreciate this work. Most of my colleagues say, oh, pagal hai, syllabus ka bahar ka padhata hai. The fellow is mad, he is teaching something outside the syllabus. Now, this is what I would like to say. Independent of the rigmarole of the syllabus and the compulsions of your own mechanism, why do we look forward to government and external forces to recognize our work? That teacher must have been deriving extraordinary pleasure. And if every year if he is able to train those 15, 10 students in this fashion, he is actually creating problem solvers of the future. Please remember this. While as teachers, we do want immediate recognition from our colleagues, our superiors, we also want our students to recognize that we have done something special. Don't you feel very happy and proud when a student whom you had taught 10 years ago suddenly meets you somewhere and says, madam, you taught me this and I am grateful, I learned something useful. Don't you feel very nice? I will tell you, as a teacher who has been teaching for 40 years, that is the biggest reward. There is no money, no honor in the world which is comparable to one student telling you that, sir, you made some difference to my life. That is the privilege of a teacher. There is absolutely no other employee of any cadre in the world who can claim that privilege except parents. Because the children are always grateful to the parents. Similarly, children are grateful to the teacher. Of course, I agree with you, there has to be a mechanism within our university system to permit greater recognition for such additional work, to permit greater recognition in terms of marks, because that is what the students understand. In IIT system, we are privileged. When I say this is a special assignment and you will get these many marks, and when I say you solve these additional questions, you will get bonus marks, I am permitted to add these marks in all kinds of ways as long as I have announced that scheme at the beginning and permit to calculate that as a grade. You unfortunately may not have that privilege, but my contention is keep fighting for it. Keep fighting for autonomy of the college. Keep fighting for autonomy of the teacher. Let me tell you that there are many institutions which are supposedly autonomous, but they in turn do not grant this autonomy to the teachers who are part of that institution. That is very unfair. So start fighting, start arguing, and don't give up, and don't get frustrated if nobody listens. That will happen for several years. You have to keep on arguing without losing your cool and keep on getting these benefits. But yes, someday we will change the system in the colleges. Thank you.
Another question, sir.
Yes, please.
First of all, thank you, sir, for your inspiring word. And I am just want to say something to you. It is not suggestion, because I am too young to give you suggestions. But I want just whatever you have told us, you could please share it to the social networking or YouTube, because I am connecting with the students with the social networking. And nowadays, students are sharing so much of movie clippings and songs on Facebook, and so much of the time is just wasted on social networking. So if you could please upload your lecture so that I can, or our faculty's colleagues could share those inspiring words among the students, so that your message, your thoughts can be directly delivered to them. If you could please, sir, do this.
Thank you so much for this suggestion, and thank you for the appreciative word. For one thing, this lecture is also being recorded, all this interaction is being recorded, and as per our principle, this recorded lecture will also form part of the released material on the website, and of course you are permitted to download it. I don't think I have the energy or time to connect now at this age to the social network and put it up, but you are most welcome to do it on your own, because all of this material is in open source. Secondly, my colleague Professor Solanki just pointed out that the madam who asked the earlier question belongs to some National Institute for Teachers Training. There used to be a TTT Bhopal, and there are some 4 such TTTs. And madam, I had interacted with one of the directors of one of the institutions, I don't know, in Chennai or some place. And my request would be that if you could perhaps try and become part of this national mission activity, because you directly deal with teachers in large numbers. And if you could imbibe this style of empowering teachers, perhaps both of us would benefit. I would like to request you to try and take this up with your own institute.
Thank you, sir. I have decided to interact with my director. I have this in mind that we will like to become a remote center for use of this technology and spreading further the inputs. Okay. And we will also like to use it for our own purpose.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think we need to stop, because there are so many questions still. But I am aware of the fact that I have eaten away practically the entire lecture slot of Professor Solanki. Let's not forget that the primary objective of all of you to have come here was to learn something and enhance the common knowledge on photovoltaic cells. So with this, with the apology for spending so much time, thank you very much.